So good evening everyone, welcome to this rapid fire session, and today we would talk about some important questions and concepts from the topic of conjunctiva. So we have done two topics, we have done about the retina, we have done about the cornea, and today is the topic for the conjunctiva. So the session would be in the same go, we would ask you the FAQs and then I would basically put the relevant explanation for all of you. Okay. So be there, and I am Dr. Vineet Sehgal. I would be taking all my sessions in the month of June on the Unacademy Learning app. I would be just telling you that there is a limited time offer for all of you where you can get a 3-year subscription at just 58,500 for the Unacademy and Prep Ladder. So as you go down, let's say 24 months, 18 months or 12 months subscription, the price decreases, but the per month price that increases. So the best advantage would be if you go for a long-term course, okay? This is a limited time offer, and also remember, for 3-month subscription, you would get 1-month subscription free of cost. With this, I would be starting my session. Before I start the session, I would be just telling you about few parts of the conjunctiva. So if you can see, what I have done is I have everted the eyelid, and after everting the eyelid, what is there is that if you can see is that one part of the conjunctiva is basically covering the sclera, and other part of the conjunctiva is basically covering the eyelid, back of the eyelid. The one which is covering the back of the eyelid, what is this called? So this conjunctiva is called palpebral conjunctiva, okay? And this conjunctiva which is covering the sclera, this is called bulbar conjunctiva. Is it clear? Now tell me, does the conjunctiva cover the cornea as well? So the answer is no. So remember, the cornea is not covered by the conjunctiva. Okay. So here you can see again in another section that this is my bulbar conjunctiva. Okay. And here you can see this is my palpebral conjunctiva, and the junction of the bulbar and the palpebral conjunctiva, that is called fornix. Okay. So these are some important parts of the conjunctival tissue. Okay. So my first question to you is, limbar stem cells are situated in which part of the conjunctiva? Your options are palpebral conjunctiva, bulbar conjunctiva, palisades of Vogt, or plica semilunaris. Try to answer. Limbar stem cells. Remember, the limbar stem cells are responsible for the growth of the corneal epithelium, and they are present at the level of palisades of Vogt. Okay, so limbar stem cells, why are they important? Because they maintain the transparency of cornea by not allowing the conjunctiva to grow over the cornea, and corneal epithelial cells only to grow. Okay, chalo, let's move to the various parts. I told you about the palpebral, fornicial, bulbar conjunctiva. Now where are the palisades of Vogt? So they are the radial ridges. If you can see here, can you see some ridges here? Okay, so like this. So they are radial ridges at the junction of limbus. Okay, this is called the palisades of Vogt. Okay, so here basically we have the limbus stem cells. Sure. Let's move to the next important portion of the eyeball. If you can see the membrane here. Now this membrane, this is called a plica semilunaris. Remember, this is basically vestigial in the human beings, but what it basically consists of, it consists of the follicles, lacrimal glands, sweat and sebaceous glands. This is the plica semilunaris. Okay. Chalo. Our next question is, mucus secreting glands are which of the following? Your options are cross, Wolfring, goblet or Mans. Which of the following are the mucus secreting glands of the eye? So why the mucus secreting glands are important? Because they form a very important layer of the tear film. When we would talk about the tear film, we would tell you that the tear film is consisting of three sub layers, that is the mucus, aqueous and the lipid layer. And the goblet cells are basically responsible for the mucus secretion. Okay, chalo. Let's move to the next spotter here. So in this spotter, the patient, let's say a 10-year-old patient, he came to the OPD with long standing chronic itching in the eyes. And when I averted the eyelid, I saw the spotter like this. What is this called? Your options are follicles or papilla. So these are the giant papillas. Okay, no, these are not the follicles. These are the giant papilla. I call it giant papillary conjunctivitis. Okay, so what is actually a papilla? It has a vascular core. Okay, so center is a vascular, and around the vascular core, you have the hyperplastic epithelium. Okay, this is basically called papilla. It is more commonly seen in the allergic conjunctivitis, but it can also be seen in the bacterial conjunctivitis, marginal conjunctivitis, as well as those patients who are having a chronic contact lens wear. Okay, chalo. What is the difference between the papilla and the follicles? Follicles are also the looking like same, but they are more whitish in character. Okay, so what they have is they have a central core of the epithelioid cells. Central core of the epithelioid cells, and around the epithelioid cells, you have the blood vessels. Okay, you have the blood vessels around the central core. This is more commonly seen in the chlamydial conjunctivitis, which is called trachoma. Okay, you can see it in the viral conjunctivitis as well as in the chlamydial conjunctivitis. Okay, let's move to our next question. Our next question is, pseudomembranous conjunctivitis is seen in which of the following? Your options are trachoma, Moraxella Axenfeld, Neisseria gonorrhoeae, or enterococcal. So pseudomembranous conjunctivitis, it is basically seen in the patients who are having a Neisseria gonorrhoeae infection. Now, what is the meaning of pseudomembrane? One is the membranous conjunctivitis. In the membranous conjunctivitis, we have the true epithelial cells covering the tissue. Okay, when we do not have the true epithelial, but what is happening is that the discharge and the cells, they are making a false epithelium, a false membrane, okay, which does not have the true epithelial cells. This is basically called a pseudomembranous conjunctivitis, okay, and it has a very important property, as Pooja have told, that they do not bleed on their removal. What are the other causes of pseudomembranous conjunctivitis? The patient suffering from adenoviral conjunctivitis, Neisseria gonorrhoeae, ligneous conjunctivitis, and the conjunctivitis which is seen after the Stephen-Johnson syndrome. Okay, so all of these are the causes of pseudomembranous conjunctivitis. Okay, chalo, let's move to our next question. A 10-year-old male patient came to the OPD with ropey discharge and cobblestone papilla on examination. No, staph and streptococcus pneumoniae, they usually do not cause a pseudomembranous conjunctivitis. Okay, so the question is, 10-year-old male patient came to the OPD with ropey discharge and cobblestone papilla on examination. I just showed you the cobblestone papilla. These symptoms aggravate in the summer month. What is the most probable diagnosis? So the things that you have to see here, 10-year-old child, so in the first decade, ropey discharge. The ropey discharge is called Maxwell-Lyon sign because of the presence of eosinophils there. Then we have the cobblestone papilla on examination. These symptoms aggravate in the summer. Okay, so what is the probable diagnosis? The probable diagnosis here is vernal keratoconjunctivitis. Okay, so remember, though it is called a spring catarrh, but it is more common in the summers. It is usually seen in the first decade of life. Okay, very important is, it is seen in the first decade of life. It has the papillas, it has the follicles, and it is usually bilateral. The next thing which the patient tells is that this comes again and again every summer. So it is recurrent. Okay, so it is recurrent and it is more commonly in summer. And what is the type of hypersensitivity reaction you see in the vernal keratoconjunctivitis? So it is a type 1 hypersensitivity reaction. Okay, it is the type 1 hypersensitivity reaction which you see in the patients of vernal keratoconjunctivitis. Is it clear? Okay, chalo, let's move to the next question. So next question is, another type of keratoconjunctivitis is called flicktennular keratoconjunctivitis. It is a type of which type of hypersensitivity reaction? Type 1, type 2, type 3 or type 4? So it is a more long standing hypersensitivity reaction. So it is a type 4 hypersensitivity reaction. What is seen in the flicktennular keratoconjunctivitis? You see a flicton. Okay, flicton is a nodule which has surrounding it there are blood vessels. Okay, surrounding it there are blood vessels. It is seen near the limbus. Okay, this is called flicktennular keratoconjunctivitis. Staph aureus and tuberculosis, they are one of the most common causes of the patient suffering from flicktennular keratoconjunctivitis. Is it clear, Dr. Lithika? Chalo. Let's move to the next question. Next question is, organism responsible for hyperacute bacterial conjunctivitis is Chlamydia, Adenovirus, Neisseria gonorrhoeae or Staphylococcus aureus. Okay, so hyperacute bacterial conjunctivitis, what is the meaning of hyperacute? That within 24 hours, within 24 to 48 hours, what is happening is there is a complete involvement of the conjunctiva, there is an involvement then of the cornea as well, there may be a corneal perforation. This conjunctivitis then goes into the bacteria goes into the anterior chamber, and then there is a massive uveitis there. After the massive uveitis, there is chances of the systemic spread of the infection. From conjunctiva, there is a basically progressively very, very fast spread of the infection to the bloodstream. This is basically characteristic of Neisseria gonorrhoeae infection. Okay, so it is the characteristic of Neisseria gonorrhoeae. As I told you, the important points are the incubation period is very short. You see a lot of inflammation of the conjunctiva, which is called chemosis. There is a purulent discharge. The transmission is from the genitals to the eye in the mother. And the complication is there is a corneal involvement followed by the iris involvement and followed by the systemic dissemination. So you need to basically give, admit the patient and give IV ceftriaxone in these patients. Okay. So the next question is, the organism responsible for the angular conjunctivitis. What is your answer? Angular conjunctivitis, there is basically the maceration of the tissues at the angles of the eye. Okay. Yahan par, there is a maceration of the tissue because of the formation of the proteolytic enzymes. Okay. So this is a characteristic of Moraxella Axenfeld bacteria. Okay. It can be a staph or it can be Moraxella Axenfeld. Okay, let's move to our next question. Next question is, fisto classification is used for which of the following? Your options are keratoconus, ophthalmia neonatorum, trachoma or uveitis. So fisto, okay, this is the follicles, intense scarring, and then we have the trichiatric and the opacity. This is the called fisto classification, and as Pooja and Litikita have told us, this is basically the classification which we have basically made for the trachoma. Okay, so what is the full form of fisto? We have the follicles, intense follicles, scarring, trichiasis and opacity. As we go down, the severity of the patient with trachoma increases. Also, sometimes they ask the question, what is the cause of blindness in trachoma? Can anyone tell me? When the blindness comes in the patient of trachoma, blindness comes when the patient comes to the O. Okay, so when there is a TO, last stage of the fisto classification, the corneal opacity. Okay, this is the cause of blindness in these patients. Okay, chalo. Let's move to the next question. Blinding trachoma is defined as, so we have in the Fisto classification, first thing, which is the follicles. So presence of the follicles in more than 5% in 1 to 9 year of age group, presence of the follicles in more than 1% in 1 to 9 year of age group, presence of the follicles in more than 5% in the total population, presence of the follicles in more than 10% in 1 to 9 year of age group. What should be your answer? Blinding trachoma. This is a definition. So remember, the answer here is A. Okay. So blinding trachoma is basically defined as if the patient is having a, or the population of 1 to 9 years, out of them 5% of them are in the first stage, or the second stage is more than 1 in the 1000 of the population. Okay, this is basically called the blinding trachoma. Okay, you basically take the prevalence in 1 to 9 year of age group. If it is the follicle, it should be more than 5%, and if it is the next stage, it should be 1 in at least 1000 population. Remember, India have eradicated the infective trachoma. Okay, it is the latest disease which has been eradicated in India. Okay, chalo. So next question is, prophylaxis of trachoma is given to whole of the population started when prevalence in 1 to 10 year of age group is more than 1%, 5%, 10% or 20%. Try to answer. So basically, is prophylaxis of trachoma, are you getting my point? Prophylaxis of trachoma, that is the eye ointment tetracycline. Twice a day for 6 weeks should be given when the prevalence in 1 to 10 year of age group should be 1%, 5%, 10% or 20%. Try to answer. So very good, Likita. The answer here is C, that is 10%. Now here you have to remember, when should we give the prophylaxis? I told you the prophylaxis is the tetracycline eye ointment. Okay, so tetracycline eye ointment twice a day for 6 weeks has to be given for the prophylaxis. When it has to be given? When the prevalence in 1 to 9 year of age group is 10% or more than 10%. If it is around 5 to 10%, then we treat only the close contacts and the family members of the patient. Okay, so here we basically treat all the population. In the first criteria, I treat all the population, and in the second criteria, we treat only the close contacts and family members. If this asks what is the drug of choice for the trachoma in the adults, it is the 1 gram single dose of azithromycin. Is it clear? Okay, chalo, let's move to our next question. Next question is, most common type of viral conjunctivitis is enteroviral, coronavirus, adenovirus or herpes. Most common type of viral conjunctivitis. So remember, the most common type of viral conjunctivitis is adenoviral conjunctivitis. Okay, it is not the herpes, it is the adenoviral conjunctivitis. It is so much important. Now, adenoviral conjunctivitis are of many types. Okay, it can be epidemic keratoconjunctivitis, it can present as the pharyngoconjunctival fever, it can present as the follicular conjunctivitis, and it can also present as the relapsing adenoviral conjunctivitis. Okay, all of them can be the presentation of a adenoviral conjunctivitis. Okay, Litika? Okay, chalo. So in the epidemic keratoconjunctivitis, they sometimes ask what is the strains that are responsible. It is the 8 plus 9, what it happens is 17. Okay, 17 plus 17, it is 34, around 34, then it is 37. Okay, so these are the strains which are responsible for the epidemic keratoconjunctivitis. Our next question is, Stoker's line is seen in which of the following? Try to answer fast. Stoker's line is responsible or seen in which of the following? Arcus, pingicula, bitot spots or pterygium? So Stoker's line are seen in the patients of pterygium. What is actually a Stoker's line? Now this is the pterygium, okay? And this is my cornea. So what is there is, there is iron deposition line around the head of the pterygium, okay? This is the iron deposition line at the head of the pterygium. This is basically called a Stoker's line. Is it clear, Pooja? Okay, chalo. Let's move to our next question. Next question is, ophthalmia nodosa is found in which of the following? Onchocercosis, caterpillar here in the conjunctiva, pseudo-exfoliation syndrome or pingicula. Ophthalmia nodosa, what happens is, because of the foreign body reaction, there is a nodule which basically forms inside the conjunctiva. And what is seen around the ophthalmia nodosa? It is the caterpillar hair. Okay, so caterpillar hair in the conjunctiva can basically cause the inflammatory reaction which can cause the ophthalmia nodosa. Okay, then we have the next question. Which of the following has the highest occurrence of regrowth after a pterygium surgery? Your options are autograft, Bayer sclera technique, mitomycin C or amniotic membrane graft. So what happens is, whenever we do a surgery for a pterygium, what happens there is that there can be a regrowth of the pterygium. Okay, this regrowth of the pterygium is very difficult to operate again. So to basically, the highest occurrence of regrowth in these patients is when you go for a Bayer sclera technique. What is the meaning of Bayer sclera technique? You have removed the pterygium and you have left the Bayer sclera. Okay, the sclera you have not covered with anything. This is, so Adarsh, it is the live lecture. Okay, so when it is not covered by anything, this is called Bayer sclera. If you cover it with the conjunctival graft, okay, this is called autograft. If you put mitomycin C, this also basically avoids having a recurrence of the pterygium. Okay, chalo, let's move to the next question. Identify this spotter, this nodule which you can see in the nasal side of the cornea. So remember, it is a non-vascular structure. So very good, Pooja, this is a pingicula. Okay, so remember, do not confuse a pingicula with a pterygium. Pterygium is the vascular outgrowth of the conjunctiva over the cornea, and the pingicula is basically a non-vascular nodular structure which is around the cornea. Remember, pingicula is a non-vascular structure. Whenever you see a flicton, flicton is also around the limbus, but it has lots of blood vessels which are coming around it, and it is not having a elevated type of structure like a pingicula. Okay, chalo, let's move to our next question. Now this patient also has a vitamin A deficiency and he comes with the foamy epithelial spots around the limbus. What is this condition called? You can see foamy epithelium around the conjunctiva. So these are seen in the patients who have the vitamin A deficiency, and this is basically called Bytot's spots. Okay, so remember, Bytot's spots are not the elevated lesions, they are the flat foamy type of lesions around the conjunctiva. Okay, we have the next question now. A patient presented with a sudden redness of eye on waking up. He is taking antihypertensive and also had an episode of violent cough a day before. What is the treatment of choice in the patient? So there is a redness of the conjunctiva, but there is no pain, inflammation or watering in the patient. Okay, so this patient is basically suffering from subconjunctival hemorrhage. Okay, the patient is suffering from subconjunctival hemorrhage. Because there is a subconjunctival hemorrhage, so the patient is not having any inflammatory signs, and this basically resolves on its own. You do not need to treat the patient. So the treatment of choice here is wait and watch. Okay, let's move to our next question. The next question is, a neonate admitted in the ICU with lung crepts presented with conjunctivitis and discharged from the eye. Which of the following organisms can be involved here? Try to answer. ICU with lung crepts with conjunctivitis and discharged from the eye. So basically this patient, because there are lung crepts are there, and ICU setting is there. The two options which are most importantly can be there is Chlamydia trachomatis and H influenza. Now, according to the reports, according to the literature, H influenza have been seen more as the cause of the ophthalmia notorum, more commonly in the ICU settings when the patient is on ventilator on or on the oxygen support. So the answer here is B, that is H influenza. Okay, chalo. The next question is, within 24 hours of birth, the child is having pink eyes. Okay, the child is having pink eyes, chemosis and watering. So all of them are the features of the ophthalmia neonatorum. Now what can be the cause here? So whenever you are seeing it within 24 hours or within 2 to 5 hours and there is the history of childbirth and putting a silver nitrate, okay, this is called a chemical conjunctivitis. Okay, this is called a chemical conjunctivitis and most commonly it is because of the silver nitrate. Why we used to put silver nitrate solution earlier? We wanted to avoid the prevalence of the Neisseria gonorrhoeae infection, but this silver nitrate itself can basically cause the conjunctivitis in a newborn child. Okay, chalo. Let's move to our next question, which was a previous year question. Question is, a child presented with the bilateral conjunctivitis and fever since 5 days and skin peeling is present. What is the most probable diagnosis? So remember, in the COVID virus also, the most common ocular manifestation is conjunctivitis. But here the patient has come with the bilateral conjunctivitis. There is a fever and there is a skin peeling. Okay, so the medium-sized blood vessels are involved. And this is the feature of Kawasaki's disease. In Kawasaki's disease, there can be other ocular manifestations also, like iridocyclitis, subconjunctival hemorrhage, superior punctate keratitis, and disc edema. Okay, chalo, let's move to our next question. Not true regarding the epidemic keratoconjunctivitis. I told you about the epidemic keratoconjunctivitis in my session today at around 15 minutes. So your options are caused due to enterovirus, causes superficial punctate keratitis, there is a pseudomembrane formation, or there are subepithelial infiltrates. What is not true regarding the epidemic keratoconjunctivitis? So the not true is enterovirus. Remember, it is not seen with the enterovirus. It is seen with which organism? It is seen with the adenovirus. Okay. And what are the strains which are responsible? 8 plus 9, what happens? 17. 17 plus 17 is equal to 34. We add 3 more there, it becomes 37. So the strains 8, 9, 17, and 37, they are basically involved or basically there for the patients of epidemic keratoconjunctivitis. Okay, so this is how a epidemic keratoconjunctivitis looks like. So you can get a punctate subepithelial infiltrates in the cornea. Okay, so these punctate subepithelial infiltrates in the cornea, they are basically pointing towards the diagnosis of adenoviral conjunctivitis. Okay, chalo, let's move to our next question. The Apollo conjunctivitis is caused by which of the following? Chlamydia, enterovirus, allergy, or contact lens? Apollo conjunctivitis. Now, it is a very famous story that this type of conjunctivitis happened in USA when there was a moon mission for the the first moon mission was there in the USA. At the launch of that vehicle, which is called Apollo launch vehicle, a conjunctivitis broke in the some areas of the USA and it is because of the enterovirus. Okay, so the enterovirus causes the Apollo conjunctivitis. It is also called hemorrhagic conjunctivitis. Okay, chalo. Let's move to our next question. A patient presented with the acute redness of eye with the mucopurulent discharge and halos, but with no staining with the fluorescein. The halos subsided after washing with the clean water and the patient responded to a 5-day course of topical antibiotics. What should be your probable diagnosis? Angle closure glaucoma, uveitis, acute bacterial conjunctivitis, or immature senile cataract? So the patient had complaint of halos. Now halos can be there in the angle closure glaucoma, immature senile cataract, uveitis and acute bacterial conjunctivitis. Now it is not a angle closure glaucoma. Why? Because the halos of the angle closure glaucoma would always persist. The halos can also be seen in the immature senile cataract, but in the immature senile cataract we do a test which is called Fincham test. Okay, Fincham test can basically tell you and distinguish between the immature senile cataract and the angle closure glaucoma. The uveitis halos, which are though rare, can get decreased after the steroid therapy is given to the patient. Acute bacterial conjunctivitis, what it causes is, it causes discharge to come in front of the cornea and this causes the halos. If we basically wash our eyes with clean water, these halos would basically clean off, and after a topical antibiotic treatment they would not come again. So all the features are basically in favor of acute bacterial conjunctivitis as the answer here. Okay, anyone having any doubt in any of the questions, just put me just let me know in the comment section. Okay, so with this I end the session. Before I end the session, I would be just telling you about the features of the plus course. This is, we have live classes, live tests and quizzes, batch courses and the structured schedule. In the iconic subscription, we have the live classes, live tests and quizzes, batch course, structured schedule. With that, we would have the advantage of the video lecture, question bank, rapid revision course and the handwritten notes. In any of the following, you can basically use the code OFTHEL10. Okay, you can use the code OFTHEL10 and get a 10% discount. Whether you are going for an iconic subscription or you are going for a plus subscription, you put this and get 10% discount on any of the package you want. Okay, and also I would say you that you can join our Telegram groups for getting the notifications. Hit the bell icon for getting all the notifications, and if you have any doubt you can ask me on the Unacademy Learning app and also on the WhatsApp and the Telegram groups of the Unacademy. Okay, before I end there, I would be just telling you that if you are a third year student or a second year student, there are lots of courses which are for there for you. That is the MBBS Foundation Professional Year 2 batch, MBBS Foundation Professional Year 3 batch, FMG Test and Analysis batch, Target Next 2022 batch, and the Season 1 NEET PG 2021 Images Revision batch. All of the batches are there and you can basically subscribe for any of the batches if you are a plus subscriber. You can also basically do a lot of MCQ practice from the question bank of the Unacademy Learning app. Download the Unacademy Learning app from the iOS store and Play store and subscribe and get links to your NEET PG preparation. With this, I end my session. If you have any doubts in any of the question, you can put it in the comment section. Now we would be having a class on Sunday and this class would be on glaucoma. Okay, so be there in our session on Sunday. We would be having one special class as well as YouTube session. It would be very useful for you. Till then, it is good night from my side and Jai Hind.